Today, we have the pleasure to hear from Mayor Jim Brainard. Mayor Brainard is Carmel's first seven-term mayor. Under his tenure, Carmel has experienced tremendous growth and prosperity. It is considered one of the fastest-growing cities in the United States, with its population growing from 25,000 to over 100,000 in the last 25 years. Parkland, green space, and trails have increased from 40 acres to more than 800, including the Monon Trail and Central Park. Mayor Brainard has implemented numerous environmental initiatives for the city of Carmel. The city has been honored with many awards for its high quality of life and our environmental initiatives, including Money Magazine's Best Places to Live in America, number 3 in 2014, and number 1 in 2012, for cities with a population of 50,000 to 300,000. Mayor Brainard is serving as a trustee and co-chair of the Energy Independence and Climate Protection Task Force for the U.S. Conference of Mayors. In November of 2013, he was appointed to the Task Force on Climate Preparedness and Resilience by President Barack Obama. Additionally, he has been a guest lecturer for Georgetown University, Butler University, Indiana University, and Purdue University, among others. The mayor has served as president of Butler University Alumni Association, was included in Butler's 50 Under 50 in 2004, and has served as a trustee of the university. He taught as an adjunct instructor at the University of Indianapolis and was named one of the most powerful Hoosiers in the world by Indianapolis Monthly. Please join me in welcoming our mayor, Jim Brainard.
I want to thank you for attending and participating in this event. And I want to thank One Zone for the opportunity they have provided for many years to have this luncheon and be able to update the community. I think quite a few members of our city council are here, and I want to recognize them for the professionalism and great job they do for our city. I look at other cities and see fighting and lack of professionalism, and we don't have that with this council here in Carmel, Indiana. So give them a big round of applause. Well, the city council serves as the legislative branch of our local government. I head up the executive branch, and as a result, I work with the department heads that we've chosen, and they work with all their departments. We have close hundreds of city employees today that work every day trying to deliver the best services possible to our community. And this is an opportunity to recognize those city employees who are here today, because they just do one heck of a job for it. All the city employees, please stand up and take a bow here. I want to recognize township officials. We have been working together for many, many years, and most recently they started their community impact program, which resulted in tremendous improvements. And so good to be in a place where you see all the different units of government and public institutions working together. The same goes for our library board, who works with us. And what a beautiful house. How many of you have been in the new remodeled library yet? Isn't that gorgeous? Not many communities have a library like that, or a staff that's as caring and careful. And we've got our great public schools too, which was the original economic development driver for Carmel many decades ago, and have continued to teach our students in such a way that they succeed and attend the best universities across the globe. Let's hear it for all those that are involved in making our schools good places. As many of you have heard by now, I recently made the decision not to seek another term as mayor. I'm in year 27. When I finish in 14 months, it'll be 28 years. But that doesn't mean I'm retiring. I want to take some time to do other things and get a lot of requests to share our strategies and successes of our city with others who want to see how their cities can benefit, and we'll have more time to do that. I know that the voters and people who live in Carmel and are smart, thoughtful people, and they will elect a leader that will keep Carmel one of the best places anywhere to live and work. And during the next 14 months, I'm going to be working hard to complete certain projects and get others off the ground. Actually, looking forward to that, because the cycles usually work for three years, campaign for one, work for 3 years, campaign for one, and I'm just going to be able to keep working and not have to worry about campaign. So be a refreshing thing for me. So we're going to continue to work, our administration, as we have since 1996, driving progress forward. We talk a lot about driving in Carmel, mainly in circles. But it's been bold ideas such as that, such as installing the world's largest roundabout network that has kept Carmel driving forward while other cities seem to be stuck in neutral. Actually, there's no neutral, either accelerating or decelerating, to keep on with the automotive metaphor, but you're either going forwards or backwards. And Carmel has been going forwards for a long time, and we want to make sure that continues. We are driving progress forward now by building a network of 145 roundabouts that make it safer. And here's a statistic everybody should know. The U.S. fatality rate per 100,000 people per year is 12. Carmel's five-year trailing average is 2. 1/6 the national average, and 1/6 our neighbor to the south. Indianapolis is right at the national average. The roundabouts make a difference. We're also trying to drive progress forward. Many, many people in the community are, by encouraging others to strive for the best in all they do. We try to lead by example. Building the Palladium, one of the world's great concert halls, and architecturally stunning buildings in our downtown. We pay attention to architecture. It helps create the sense of place and pride that is so important for Carmel. And I think that's inspired private sector developers to follow suit and pay more attention to the architecture and how their buildings look. It's that cumulative whole that makes it so important. Great architecture inspires and elevates the entire experience of being in our city, and it's part of our civic wealth, and that's important. We don't just want to be the best city in the Midwest or Indiana. We want to be the best city anywhere, and we're well on our way to doing that. We're often counted among national publications as one of the best cities anywhere in which to live, be safe, raise a family, retire, be a veteran, start a new business. In fact, let me read some of these. 2022, according to a company called Turpia, number one best city in Indiana to visit and live. 2022 by a company called NerdWallet. Best small city in America, number two. Also this year, from the Safewise Insurance Companies, we're the number three safest city to live. Niche Magazine, number one best place to live in Indiana. Number one best place to raise a family in Indiana. Number one place with the best public schools in Indiana, all from the same publication. You think of retirement, there's a lot of beautiful places to retire, but Money Magazine said Carmel, Indiana in 2022 is the best place in the United States to retire. I like this one. A company called Insurify Insights listed Carmel as the most caring City in Indiana. Same time, The Economist magazine, everyone knows The Economist, one of the most respected journals of any publication in the English-speaking world, published in Britain. Page 22, a few weeks ago, full-page article on the city of Carmel. And it just wasn't roundabouts, which is often our shtick to get international publication. It was about city planning and about how suburbs can create quality places if they focus on people, not just cars. November 21st, last year, Sunday, New York Times. Somebody told me over 40 million people read that. We were on the front page talking about environmental savings from Carmel's roundabouts. And just recently, CBS Evening News goes out all over the world, of course, featured Carmel and its city planning and roundabouts. People say, why do you focus so much on this international press, national press? It's because it promotes our city. This is the best economic development we can do, getting that name out in front of people. Front page of New York Times, if you could buy it, which you can't, we could never afford it. It would be millions and millions of dollars to have that in front of 40 million people on a Sunday when people have time to read. This is how we promote our city, and it's very important to our economic development strategy. We are a community that continues to build beautiful structures, a walkable core, and welcoming public spaces. But there's other things that we have built and are continuing to build that are not tangible. Hopefully, we have built trust and pride in our community. The city, citizens of Carmel, put your trust in me as I outlined the ideas many years ago for a new downtown, a thriving arts and design district in the old town that wasn't big enough to be a downtown for a landmass that's twice the size of Manhattan. You put trust in us when I talked about focusing our economic development on the arts and building an entertainment and cultural center, on building a walkable and bikeable core in a suburb when hardly any other suburbs were doing that, and probably the biggest leap of faith, roundabouts. And I think the community took pride in seeing ideas that they shared be adopted, because we listened to people throughout the community and said, what type of community do you want us to be? You have chosen to raise your families here, build your business here, spend your life here. What would you like to see for your community? And that, because of that community involvement and thoughtfulness, I know that Carmel will continue to succeed. So Carmel is driving progress forward by creating a safe community and welcoming diversity. I want to talk about that for a minute, given the events that have been in the national news the last few days, the unfortunate events. For communities to succeed, they must welcome everybody from every background, every faith, every race, every place of origin. And it's more than just, somebody said to me the other day, I think we're a tolerant community. And my reply was, we need to be more than tolerant. We need to accept people with different backgrounds. City of Carmel, so proud of our police department. They are so transparent. Go to their website someday and see the amount of information that's there. We have low taxes in Carmel. I'll talk more about that later. And we're attracting a well-qualified workforce. People can work from anywhere today. Many people can. And they're choosing Carmel to work from. I ran into somebody just a few days ago. They moved here from California. And they said, well, we got online and saw some of the best places to live in the country. We were tired of high taxes. And they can run their business from anywhere. And they chose Carmel out of the blue. So that publicity that we get does pay off. One of the great economic advantages Carmel has, we have this great workforce, thousands of people coming here to work every day that don't even live in Carmel. We have 130 some corporate headquarters of national or regional significance. But what we don't have, and this is good, is one company that dominates our landscape. Remember, a company outside of Kansas City was in one suburb with 14,000 employees, moved across the line into the other suburb with 14,000 employees, and the tax base changed so much the first community almost went under. We're far more diverse than that. None of our companies have more than 2,000 employees, but we have 130 of them with hundreds of employees. And so we have a very diverse, stable workforce, and that's important. We have many small businesses and entrepreneurs, which is also important. And as I look out today, and as I was wandering around before the luncheon, I saw so many friends and talented individuals who have created successful companies here in Carmel. And we are honored that you had faith in the community, faith to build your businesses here. Building a business, taking those risks isn't easy, and we recognize that. We have a lot of high-tech and software professionals. That's important to our community as well, experts in art and design, and a growing healthcare sector. We have many people who have chosen to retire in Carmel. I ran into another couple a few days ago. They had moved to Florida after their kids were grown and they'd taken retirement. They were there for about a year and a half. They told me they missed Carmel. They're going to visit Florida, but they moved back here. Veterans. This is a good place for veterans. Veterans who risk everything to serve our country. We want them to have a place to flourish, to be able to retire, and to enjoy life. And families, with our great school system, the safety here, the walkability for children, it's a great place for families. And the growing cultural and ethnic diversity is also important. And how we treat those issues of acceptance is important because children are always watching. We can tell them what to do all day, but we know how children learn. They observe us and copy what we do. So to make affirmative statements that this city has to be a welcoming, diverse, and accepting place is important for the next generation because they are watching. We're driving forward, too, with financial strength. We can't progress if we don't grow, and we can't grow a quality community if we don't invest in it. And because of those investments, we have some of the lowest city tax rates in Indiana or the United States. In fact, I asked a couple things to be put up on the slide. Yes, they're up. We started tracking that house that you see on Dunes Drive, just off Main Street, west of 31. We chose that house at random. It was an Estridge house, and we picked one in Fishers and one in Lawrence and some other places back in 1998 just to do a comparison. So it was a random address we chose. So if the owners of that house are here, don't think we singled you out. It was before I looked it up. It was before they owned it many years ago. But we've continued to track that house because it's interesting. In 1998, property taxes on that house were $2,813 a year. This year, they're less, $2,769. That's after 25 years of inflation. In fact, I went to my computer yesterday and on the inflation calculator that the Bureau of Labor Statistics put out, I put $2,813 in for 1998 to see what, after applying inflation, what that would be today. It was $5,123. So if you calculate inflation in it, not only is it less in real dollars, in dollars, it's almost half of what it was. Part of that we owe to the state to put a 1% cap on property taxes. Well, a lot of it's owed to our department heads who run this city in an efficient, thoughtful way. It's because we do annual fiscal planning that projects our expenses and revenues out into the future so that when we make decisions, we do it based on data and science, not on emotion. At the end of 2021, December 31st of last year, City of Carmel had more than $85 million in unencumbered fund balances. In fund balances. Just under $70 million of that was unencumbered money. In other words, savings. And that's a sign of fiscal strength. Our general fund balance closed with over $12.5 million, an increase of over $1 million from the year before. And our rainy day fund balance remained at over $11 million. We manage our city's finances prudently. We, as I mentioned, do budget forecasting. We refinanced some bonds recently before the rates went up, 1.99%. You don't get a 1.99% rate if you don't have good credit and good fiscal management. That one refinance saved over $17 million in interest payments. Our economic development strategies, which help drive us forward, differ from most. We know that we have to focus on a quality of life. I was looking for the mountain out there this morning as I drove, and I couldn't find it. It must have been covered up by the clouds. I also didn't see the ocean. Of course, it's become a cliche. We don't have those things here. And so if we're going to attract the quality workforce, if we're going to be able to attract the best and brightest employees to Carmel, Indiana, we have to make sure it's a beautiful, vibrant, welcoming, friendly, great city. And why is that important? It's important because if our corporate citizens can't attract the best and brightest employees, they will choose not to expand here, and they may leave. So we have to make sure, working with the private sector, that Carmel is a tremendous place to live. And then the HR departments, our companies that are out there trying to recruit the people they need, their job will be easier. And Carmel will profit because of that. An acquaintance of mine who spent most of his life in the Phoenix area in economic development, Mark Lautman, wrote a book about 13, 14 years ago now. And the title of the book was When the Boomers Bail. When the Boomers Bail. He's talking about people like me and a few others I see out in the room, people that were born between 1946 and 1964, the baby boomer generation. So when I got out of grad school, I pretty much would have gone anywhere for the right job. And there's probably a lot of people in the room that would say the same thing. But as I talk to the friends of my 30 and 20-year-old children today, so many of them are picking out what city they want to live in, moving there, and then saying, oh, let me brush off my resume and find a job. It's a very different approach than what we had than what we did. And so making certain, that's why all those awards and publicity that we get are so important to our economic development. People read those across the country and across the world, and Carmel competes for this workforce development. We had one of the lowest, actually I think it was one of the business magazines a few months ago, in 1 week said that Carmel had the lowest unemployment rate in the entire country. And so I've got the statistics here somewhere, but it's been under 2 for over the last year, under 2%. And in my lifetime, that's extremely low. Usually 4 to 5% unemployment was considered healthy and normal unemployment. So we have to work hard on making sure our employers can attract the people they need to conduct their businesses. So when we design our public places, we pay attention to that. Downtown Carmel needs to be fun. It needs to be exciting. That helps us with this recruitment. We've tried to design our public spaces. You know, we haven't done a very good job as a country designing our cities since the end of World War II. You know, everything's based around the car. You drive into your garage. You can't walk anywhere you actually need to go because there aren't any stores close by. You might know your neighbors, a couple doors on each side of your house, but after that, you probably don't. We haven't focused on building public spaces where people from all these different backgrounds and places, and religions and races, have an opportunity to get to know each other. We used to have the town squares, and everybody went to that town square on the weekend. They'd shop there. There'd be concerts there. We've gotten away from that in many ways in this country. So what Carmel has done, we've tried to focus on reestablishing that area, building places where people from throughout the community can come to a downtown that they feel they belong to and have opportunities to get to know other people, many of whom come from different places and different backgrounds in our city. So we have lunchtime music at Midtown Plaza. We have our Wednesday night concert series. We have high school senior photo shoots at the Palladium, weddings at the gazebo. We have the German Christmas market where we celebrate not just Christmas, but Hanukkah as well. We have landmark venues for international performances, the Center for the Performing Arts, the Feinstein Club, and the Hotel Carmichael. We have cultural diversity festivals, the Mooncake Festival from China, as well as the German Festival. And I know there were many Diwali celebrations going on Monday as well. And that helps create the synergy and the excitement and makes Carmel a more fun place to live. I think it's important how we interact as a community. We have worked hard to try to create and foster and maintain civility in this city, both in politics, in our daily lives, and world-class cities do that. World-class cities need to protect people and support institutions that support civility. We must always have high standards of respect and behavior while recognizing differences, differences of opinion, appreciate our commonalities and work together for the betterment of all of us. It used to be in politics, I think back to the Nixon-Kennedy debates when I was a kid. I went back and watched them recently, and it was so different. You know, they went to great pains to say, you know, he's a really nice guy. I respect him tremendously, but I think that's a bad idea. So many times today, if you disagree with somebody, it's criminal. They're a terrible person. They're out to destroy the country. Why can't we just get back to the idea that we're all unique humans? And we're going to disagree on the best way forward and then sit down and compromise those differences and remain friends and respectful of each other. And we need to do that. We've been doing that in this city. We need to continue to do that. It's important. We're trying to provide more opportunities for active outdoor lifestyles, particularly in the winter, or ice skating or ice sculpture contest. In the winter, as well as biking and our parks. I think something else is important as a city and as a community that's attempting to be innovative. We can't be afraid to try new ideas. We wouldn't have any roundabouts if we hadn't tried new ideas. We wouldn't have a walkable downtown in what was formerly a car-only suburb if we hadn't tried new ideas. And because of those new ideas, November 21st, 2021, front page of the New York Times. That's good for our city. The Economist Magazine, CBS National News. It's because we tried new and innovative things. We made mistakes, of course we have. But we can't be afraid to carefully look at data and try to figure out better ways of doing things. Carmel now has over 57,000 people that commute here every day. More people commute into Carmel to work than leave Carmel to work. And that wasn't always the case. And because of that, here's an example of unemployment numbers. In August, it was 2.0. Last January, it was 1.4. And it's been in that range since then. Examples of some of our great companies. Brown & Bailey, Advanced Engineering Center in Carmel Drive. Manhattan-based Simplify relocated software headquarters to Main Street. Medical Arts Office Building and New Rehabilitation Hospital. For those East Siders, Needlers at 126 and Gray. I got more calls about that empty grocery store than almost anything over the years. A new Franciscan Orthopedic Center. Kinetic Advantage, a newly created automotive floor plan financing company, adding more than 200 high-paying jobs, investing more than $4 million in our city, expanding their headquarters on the Meridian Corridor. And we must stay prepared for growth to continue to drive progress forward. Our last annexation, unfortunately, I never have to do another annexation in my life, but it was so important that we did 56 annexations to keep our tax rate low, for the economies of scale that we obtain, to make sure that service delivery was consistent throughout the city, and home place area around 106, and college is our last one a few years ago, and recently we've 300 homes that didn't have access to city water, now do. We've added over 100 new fire hydrants, which will help insurance rates and provide better fire safety in that area. We're investing millions of dollars in intersections and road improvements in the home place area. And I predict that'll be a vital and vibrant neighborhood in Carmel for many years to come. Since I addressed you last year, our Department of Community Services, which handles, among other things, planning and zoning, has updated their land use plan. City Council has worked on that, as well as our Advisory Volunteer Plan Commission. Redevelopment. So much of Carmel's growth has been based on our redevelopment or development of our downtown area. When I first campaigned for mayor in 1995, I knocked on thousands of doors and asked people what their hopes and dreams and aspirations were for the city they had chosen to make their home. And the same theme came back in dozens of different ways, but it was, I wish we had a downtown. I wish there was a place to go for a dinner and a show without having to drive to another city. I wish I could walk to some stores. Wish we had parkland. And what these people were saying in so many different ways, they were yearning for a traditional downtown, the type of downtown that hadn't really been built in the United States since the conclusion of World War II, when we started to build for cars and forgot about building for pedestrians. So after I became mayor, I started to ask, being a lawyer, I thought, you know, why aren't our cities? You know, many of us have been fortunate enough to go to the old cities of Europe, some of the older New England towns, and we see these beautiful cities and towns, and it begs the question, why can't our new towns, our suburbs, look like these places? Well, after the war, we threw out all the rules about city design and built roads. And it's important to be able to move people and goods around safely and efficiently. That's been the case for thousands of years. We've known that. But we also need to make, to humanize our cities so that pedestrians can get out and walk, meet their neighbors, and enjoy their city from somewhere besides behind their steering wheel. And so what were the legal and financial hurdles? I mean, has anybody gone for a romantic walk past the big box parking lot recently? That's what we were trying to change. So we realized that our cities originally were built, we didn't get over 25% car ownership until after World War II, had been built for pedestrians. We had to put those cars somewhere when people came to the downtown. And land is inexpensive in this part of the country, and so a developer couldn't afford to put that parking structure in underground or in a garage. not in a place like Carmel. The land was too cheap. It was easier to go cut down trees on the edge of town and pop up some houses with a retail strip mall and a big parking lot. But that's not what we wanted in our downtown area. So we figured out if we use tax incremental financing, we could get those cars underground and in garages. We could put a building around that parking structure so it looked nice, focus on great architecture, and accommodate people's cars, but design for pedestrians. And that's what set our city aside from almost every other suburb in the country, is that we managed to move it from a suburb where you had to drive almost everywhere one needed to go to a place where we have this beautiful walkable downtown today. And so our redevelopment team has done a great job. Volunteer commissioners, Economic Redevelopment Corporation, the staff in the redevelopment department, currently today in negotiations or under discussion, we have over $2.1 billion of investment being discussed in our city. That's not an M for million, that's 2.1 billion with a B. Almost 20 current projects our redevelopment commission is working on, and you've seen some of them. You see the cranes all over town. This is gonna be great for our tax base. It's gonna be great for people who choose to move to Carmel in the future, and certainly great for the people who live here now. Last year, I was able to talk a lot about Republic Airways. I drove past their site on the way here today. It's going up so quickly. What a great corporate headquarters to get in Carmel. It's going to have 300-some trainees here almost every day of the year. It's like a permanent convention of 300 people on a per diem, spending money in our restaurants and our shops. Let me explain very quickly how tax incremental finance works. You've got a couple hours, right? Yeah, I thought so. I'll try to keep it simple. That's why a lot of cities don't do it, because it's not all that simple. But our staff has figured it out and been a leader at this. You see two blobs up there on the screen in blue. On the left is your typical strip center. That's meant to be an overhead view of a little shopping center. The rest of it is surface parking. Let me tell you a secret. Parking lots don't pay anything in property tax. And so, you know, roads cost $12, $15 million a mile for a two-lane road from scratch today. Fire stations are expensive. The farther you go out, policing's expensive. Water lines, sanitary sewer lines, all these things are expensive. And if you sprawl out and take 10 times the land mass that you have taken, if you've gone up 4 to 5 stories, you just increase your cost by that increment. Sprawl is very, very expensive. And so the building on the right is a 5-story building. We don't really want to go above 5 or 6 stories. There's a lot of issues when you go build skyscrapers, too. But some of the most beautiful cities in the world were pre-structural steel built as 5-6-story cities, very dense, walkable. But look at the difference in revenue on that slide. It's in some cases, we've seen examples 50 to 60 times more revenue because property tax is paid per square foot. So you set a base year. That money goes into a fund, say 80% of it's used to build that parking garage or structure that otherwise wouldn't have been affordable for the developer, couldn't have made money, bank wouldn't have approved it. But we'll pay for that with the increase in property taxes. But the 20 or 10%, whatever is left over, is still many multiples of what we were getting if that was a 1-story strip center. So it makes all sorts of fiscal sense to do these projects in our downtown area. And then in 25 years, when those TIF loans, which generally the city doesn't even sign now, I won't say always, but generally doesn't, the developers sign them. And if there was a financial crisis, the developer wasn't able to pay property taxes, bank doesn't come after the taxpayers, it's only can go after that building. So there's very little risk to the taxpayers. And in 25 years, when those loans are paid off, our revenue is going to be 25 to 50, in some cases 60 times what it would have been had that single story strip center with that big service parking lot been there instead. So we try to analyze, from a fiscal standpoint, all our zoning and redevelopment decisions. It's complicated. It's difficult to put these deals together. As a result, we're doing a lot for the developers. We can also then ask for better architecture. And there's enough money left over for the brick streets and the fountains and the flowers and public art and all the things that are kind of the icing on the cake that people like at the end of the day. So that's why we do tax incremental financing or TIF projects. The environment is important, too. I've always believed that we have a moral and ethical responsibility to leave the earth in better condition than we found it. It's our home. And, you know, science has pointed out more recently that we need to do a better job of that. And we can't affect necessarily national and international policy here in Carmel, Indiana, but if every city across the country starts to do the right thing, we can make vast improvements. If cities in other continents, other places, see what the United States is doing at a city level, they will copy us, and the earth will be a safer, better, cleaner place. Think about mixed-use developments. The average American drives 2 hours a day in their car, 5 days a week at least. And that's an average. So that means that people in certain places are driving 3, 4, 5 hours a day. I was talking to somebody that had moved here from San Diego not too long ago, and they say, yeah, I couldn't afford the house near my office. I was living 2.5 hours away, 2.5 hour commute each way, twice a day. And of course, a lot of people in New York, Chicago, and Boston, and D.C. that don't have cars and walk places or take public transit. So that 2 hour average is a lot of people driving longer. And so that's not good for our environment. It's also not good for that person's quality of life. It's not good for the taxpayers. We have to build all those roads. And mixed use development is better than single use development. What the planners back in the early 1900s called Euclidean zoning. It made sense back then, because you still had noxious factory fumes, and when they started to do single-use zoning, put the factories over here and the houses over here, longevity went up by a decade in just a few years' time. But today, that doesn't make any sense. It did 120, 130 years ago. Today, it doesn't make any sense. So in downtown Carmel, instead of places I know of in California where people drive 7 to 10 miles to the grocery store, people can walk to a market, they can drive a couple blocks to a grocery store, to several grocery stores. Same with the dry cleaners and the doctor's office. Using mixed-use development cuts down on car trips, cuts down on the number of $12 million a mile roads that we have to build. So the mixed use has a great environmental benefit as well. If you get interested in that topic, read Jeff Speck's book, Urban Sprawl, Rise of Sprawl and the Decline of the American Dream. It's a great book. Our bike and trail system, providing alternative methods of transportation, is healthier and it's good for us, and it cuts down on car emissions. We've done quite a few solar projects in Carmel now. Some of our parking garages have solar panels on the tops. We did 2 big solar arrays out by our utility facilities on the south, in the southeast quadrant of Carmel, so that we also save a lot of money. We're getting about a 10% return on investment on those projects by not in reduced electricity costs. Our roundabouts continue to improve air quality and reduce gas consumption. Our engineering consultants and staff calculated, this is a rough number, of course, based on reasonable assumptions, there's over $11 million saved a year by Carmel drivers by not stopping at stoplights and not starting from dead zero most of the time. That's a lot of money, cumulatively, and a lot of emissions that don't go up in the air. Somebody said to me the other day, we need to get more electrical charging stations. And the person's right, we do, but we do have 62 in the city of Carmel today. You can look them up and find a map of them. We use hybrid vehicles in our city fleets, and we're looking more and more at using more electric, 100% electric vehicles. We're driving progress forward in technology and communications. We're replacing our aging water meters. This continues. The technology allows us to read them remotely. We don't need as many meter readers. We're expanding, so no one will lose a job, but they can be reassigned. We'll save money there. We're building a new IT building, which is nearing completion. We have a refreshed website, carmel.in.gov, for quick access to the most used areas. And we have a new separate economic development website in Carmel. So write this down. It's choosecarmelin.com. choosecarmel.in.com. I'm so proud of the staff that put it together. It's a great website. We're the test city for Volkswagen, the seventh largest corporation in the world, largest car company in the world last year. We're their test city nationally for some smart city software we're helping them develop. And we hope that they choose to put some of their North American offices here soon as well. We're working on that. And the Volkswagen, they're looking at vehicles, pedestrians, bicyclists, our camera network that we use for public safety, how to connect that with software to better and more efficiently deliver public safety and other services to the community. Fascinating software. I mentioned before we have a new comprehensive land use plan. That's important as we move forward. It's not the law. It's a guide to future zoning decisions. We're looking, as we get denser in the core, we're looking at how best to move people around bad weather days and people don't have time to walk from place to place. We're looking internal, not connecting with any other cities at this point, but just internally in the downtown area, how we might someday provide public transit in that area. And we've hired consultants. We're looking at it, and the Volkswagen study is helping us too, because with that software now, we know cars started at A, is moving to B, how many people are in that car, what time of day, how long it took on that route at different times of day, the amount of data that we have to work with. Used to be, I think, people plop down a bus line, so the street looks busy, let's see what happens. When we get to the point we're ready to make those decisions in this city, we will have tremendous amounts of data. One of my pet peeves has always been that cities don't have sufficient data upon which to make good decisions. We will in this area in Carmel. During the next year, in 2 months, we got 14 months left, we're going to continue to make progress in this city. We're going to work hard. We're going to drive our progress forward. There are absolutely no plans to slow down. It's vital to the future of our community that we inspire this and future generations to continue to build a community that will thrive for years to come. And we've shown that's possible. Successful cities never stop investing in themselves. Just as most of you here today invest heavily into creating a successful business, so too will Carmel invest in our community. Carmel is a city that never stops. It's a slogan that describes more than just our roundabouts. That's why we will continue to drive progress forward to make Carmel a great city for everyone. Thank you.